Infants and young children with GLUT1 deficiency have characteristic episodes of unusual eye movements. And people will describe these episodes typically as looking like the eyes are darting around as if they're looking at a moving target. And the episodes typically last a few minutes. And they're something that start at a very young age, typically in the first 6 months of life often, and persist through the early years of childhood.
At the age of 4 months, my son began having episodes of rapid eye and head movements. His eyes and head would move in multiple directions. He seemed awake through these events, and the event would last anywhere from 30 to 90 seconds. He did seem in some discomfort through these episodes. After they were done, he would just yawn and seem tired, and then he would be fine afterwards. I stopped nursing Dominic around the age of 4 months, simultaneous to when these episodes began. His feedings were extending out longer, so whereas he would begin feeding every 2 hours, he was now feeding every 4 hours. I would notice that we would sit him in his high chair to begin feeding him baby food, and this is when the episodes would happen. Now looking back, it seems that his body was starving for some glucose, and this is why he was having these episodes. Dominic is now 11 years old. I would say that the eye movement episodes stopped around the age of 9 months, and his symptoms evolved into other things, such as global developmental delays, movement disorder episodes, and even other uncommon symptoms, such as alternating hemiplegia of the upper and lower body.
Actually, this is something very interesting we just found out over the past recent years. They are the earliest sign of GLUT1 deficiency. So even before the first seizures start, parents been telling us that they observed these funny eye head movements, which didn't appear to be seizures, but did impair their children. And eventually we understood that this is one of the earliest symptoms of this entity.
So there's some important characteristics that distinguish the eye movements in GLUT1 deficiency from other types of abnormal eye movements like opsoclonus or nystagmus. The first thing that's important to realize is that the GLUT1 eye movements are really movements of the eyes and the head together. The eyes and the head move in the same direction. The speed of the movements is also important in that they tend to occur one or two times per second, in contrast to movements like opsoclonus, where the movements are much, much faster than that and usually more frequent. The movements in themselves are what we'd call normal movements in the sense that all of us make the types of movements that occur in the episodes, looking around. What makes them unusual, the fact that they're occurring involuntarily as a cluster. In contrast, in movements like opsoclonus or nystagmus, the movements might be more continuously there, or at least could be seen on examination. I couldn't imitate that movement. The other thing would be it's clearly an abnormal eye movement where I or someone else could not voluntarily imitate that eye movement. It looks very distinctly different, and it's restricted to the eyes, very importantly. They do not involve the head at all.
We are unsure what causes or triggers the eye-head movements in infancy and early childhood. What's interesting is that it seems to be limited to that age period and is not seen in school-age children or adults. But having said that, we only learned about that a few years ago, and there is much to do to understand pathogenic mechanisms why these eye-head movements occur. What we do see is that they are not epileptogenic because the EEG usually is normal.
Importantly, the eye movement episodes are the most common first symptom of GLUT1 deficiency, more common even than seizures as the earliest symptom. So they are a very crucial opportunity to recognize a specific diagnostic feature and at an early age, so that if we can recognize the episode for what it is, do diagnostic testing to confirm a diagnosis of GLUT1 deficiency, then and that enables us to start early treatment, which is really important for long-term outcomes in this disease.
I think the role these IHAD movements can play in an early diagnosis is that you make the diagnosis. So it's crucial that you treat GLUT1 deficiency, you diagnose and treat it as early as possible because we have an effective therapy. And these IHAD movements really do help to understand that this could be this entity and then do the appropriate diagnostic tests to prove that it's GLUT1 deficiency and then start the ketogenic diet. So training physicians to be aware of this quite characteristic IHAD movements is essential for making an early diagnosis. The expertise to recognize these IHAD movements really, first of all, is in the parents. And what would be very helpful is if they observe these funny movements from their babies, that they should record it in small videos on their iPhones and just share it with the physician and say, look, this is abnormal. Can you make sense of it? What could it be? And then eventually these videos can tell us that we suspect GLUT1 deficiency. So the first expert really are parents, because they see there's something wrong with their child and the movements and the eye movements. And then the second step is to train neuropediatricians to look at these videos and say we should look for GLUT1 deficiency.